Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal. Welcome to my channel. I am a mentor for RBI and related government examinations. And today we are going to talk about something very, very important. If you're planning to give RBI 2019, 2020, it's very important. It becomes all the more and very, very important that you analyze past year paper in full details. And that's what we're going to do today. So what we're going to do is we're going to analyze the finance and management paper today. We'll analyze all the expected questions, all the possible questions that we could find along with their answers, along with their options. But the focus is going to be on analyzing the kinds of questions that are being asked and not exactly on the question that has been asked. Okay, so we're going to focus on the topic that has been asked and how are they confusing you, to what level are they confusing you. So without wasting any time, let's start with the session. You're going to have a split screen now. I will be visible to you, and at the same time you will be able to see the question paper as well that has been created. Okay, so this is the paper that you can see out here. This is the past year analysis of finance and management for the year 2018 that you can see out here. If you want to inquire about my courses, you can use the contact points which have been mentioned below. You can either contact me on successrba@anujindal.in, or you can call me on 9999466225. This particular PDF will also be put forward on the website, that is www.anujindal.in. So you can go there and you can also check out all these there as well. Okay. So without wasting any time, let's finally jump towards the entire finance and management paper, which was asked in the year 2018. This is the broad classification of the kinds of questions and the number of the weightage of every area. Now, one thing too important here is that we have not been able to find the exact number of questions or all the questions that were asked. This is purely based upon the feedback given by my students. So although it says 45 marks for management, we might have been able to find worth 42 marks only or 41 marks only. But we are sure that 45 marks worth of paper was approximately 45 marks worth of paper was directly from the management section. Okay, so we'll start with management and then we'll move towards finance, ratios, and finally the question related to computer section that was asked. Now, management, there are two markers and one marker. So I've divided the entire PDF into two markers and one markers. Starting with two markers that were asked in the section of management, total of 8 marks worth of questions were asked from organization structure, which is rather high because the syllabus focuses on organization behavior and HRM and does not focus upon organization structure. So this shows us directly that RBI is not following or does not follow the syllabus when it comes to management. I have been saying this for a long time, and it's important that you realize that. Do not stick to the syllabus. A lot of areas have been asked which are not mentioned directly in the syllabus as well. Okay, so the first question is, what type of structure is flexible and adaptable? Now what they're doing is they're asking you whether you have understood the primary differentiating factor of all these kinds of structures. So there's organic structure, there's mechanistic, there's none, and there's boundaryless. A lot of students might get confused and would have got confused between organic and boundaryless. But the answer here is boundaryless, because that is the one which is flexible and adaptable. So what do you realize from here? You realize that keywords related to all the important concepts are important. That's what I've been telling you guys. Keywords and concept, that is, these are the two things that you need to focus upon. Focus upon keywords related to every concept and understanding of the concept. That's what's being asked here. And it was very easily doable. It was covered in the syllabus, covered in the material that I had provided. And I'm happy and proud to announce that almost 95% of these 45 marks worth of questions were directly from the course that had been created, because it was very exhaustive in nature. Let's come to the second question. Type of departmentalization on the basis of occupation. So I had taught this in great details. You have functional, and then you have matrix, which is a combination of functional and product. So the answer here is functional. Very easy. I had given the example of hospital as well in the videos that I had created for the enrolled students. I remember that very clearly. Third question. So this one again coming from organization structure. Third question, type of authority where people have direct responsibility for fulfilling organizational goals. Direct responsibility, another keyword that you have to remember. The answer is line. So the basic difference between line and staff had been explained to you in the videos, all the enrolled students. It had been explained in great details in the videos along with examples, and that has been asked directly here. So very important yet very simple questions that have been asked this time. Type of power where subordinates can be punished. Very easy question. Even if you don't understand or have not read about power, which although had been discussed in the course, you can easily answer this question. Coercion is basically forcing someone to do something. So when you're punishing someone, you're basically forcing somebody to do something that he or she does not want to do. So coercion or coercive power logically becomes the answer. Now, the key to remember here, the most important thing to remember here is that you have to understand the meanings of all these words or keywords that have been mentioned here, because HRM, OB, OT, all these three, the entire management runs around keywords only. The confusion can be created by mentioning keywords that you might not know. So the answer is coercive here. Again, was discussed and covered in great details in the syllabus, in the course that had been created. The next question is control, which once put in system operates automatically. Now this was not covered because control had never been asked, not mentioned in the syllabus, not mentioned or covered in a lot of books that are available out there. Control, which once put in system operates automatically. But you can easily answer this question. I'll tell you how. Cybernetic, connected with cyber, connected with internet. Non-cybernetic, automatically goes out, not futuristic enough. Control, which once put in system operates automatically. Automaticity is directly connected with something which is involved or which has internet as a part of it. Let it be artificial intelligence, let it be, any other form of digital transformation that is taking place in control systems. And strategic has no relationship with automatic or non-automatic as such. So the answer very clearly becomes cybernetics. I don't know what was the fourth and fifth option, if there was any. But I'm very sure if these were the three options and the fourth one was not so confusing, you could have found out the answer even if you did not know the answer. So the important thing again here to remember is that you're running around or playing with keywords here. That's what a student who got selected recently, rank 11, Abhishek, we created an interview recently, and he mentioned or he talked about the same thing, that there were a lot of questions wherein if you understood and if you played a smart move by analyzing the keywords that had been mentioned, you could easily answer a lot of questions. So being smart in the examination hall, not relying just upon your knowledge, and at the same time showing presence of mind, all these two or both of these moves or features become very important in such a high tension environment. Inventory control, which minimizes holding and ordering cost while avoiding stock out cost. Now this was a difficult question if you had not covered inventory control, not from the syllabus, out of the syllabus. A lot of students who are from commerce background also found it difficult because they got confused between EOQ and just-in-time. EOQ and just-in-time. We had covered Kaizen in management, but we had not covered EOQ and just-in-time. Although under CVP analysis, I had covered EOQ in minute details, not in great details, very briefly. But just-in-time, unfortunately, had not been covered. The answer here is EOQ. And a lot of students got confused because they thought that just-in-time and EOQ are synonymous, or they were not able to differentiate between these two out here. But the answer was EOQ. So this tells us that there will always be some questions which will be out of the syllabus. So you need to be comfortable with it. You need to take it head on. You don't need to panic when you experience such questions in the examination. The next one is inventory control, which uses cards. Now this one is important. See, the interesting thing here is that both these questions are connected. Kanban is mentioned here, Kanban is mentioned here, just-in-time is mentioned here. The answer to this one is Kanban. So if you are aware about these terms, you could have easily answered the other one as well. But if you're not aware about this one, you could not answer the other one as well. So even if you were aware about EOQ and just-in-time, you could have got through and you could try and answer this particular question, but no problem. Control that makes speculations for deviations rather than after they have occurred. Now, this is a very smart question which requires you to show presence of mind. If you do not make that move while you're preparing for the exam, you are going to find it difficult to clear the examination with just knowledge as your base. Okay, so what I'm talking about here is, the question says, control that makes speculations for deviations rather than after they have occurred. So what we're talking about is real time. What we're talking about is real time movement or real time, control or coverage of deviations. For example, recently I covered certain videos on portfolio management and I gave a beautiful example there. If there is a Coke bottle and it is supposed to be, have a volume of 500 ml, and the standard deviation which has been found out is, let's say, 5%. So 10% is 50, 5% is 25. So it's going to be 475 to 525 ml. This is the expected, or this is the accepted deviation. Now, if the bottle goes out of this, the filling up of the bottle of the sweet water goes out of this, then there's a need to have a check. Now, if this is done real time on a regular basis with every bottle or with sample at the end of the day, then we are involving in concurrent control, because we are checking things as and when they happen. Now, it is connected with concurrent audit that we had covered. So there are different kinds of audits. There is year-end audit, there is external audit, internal audit, concurrent audit, and concurrent audit happens in banks all the time. So if you're working in a bank, even if you did not know what this question was talking about, you could have answered the question just by looking at the options. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. Making a smart move, trying to understand the demand and the need of the question, and also eliminating based upon the answer choices that have been provided to you. Okay, so those are the things which are very important for you. The next one is from leadership theory, which takes task structure and consideration into account. The question could not get easier. We had covered it in great details. All the variations of managerial grid had also been covered, and it's a very simple and basic question. You should be able to answer this question directly coming from leadership. This shows that you have to cover all the possible coverage is important, all the possible theories of leadership involving the traditional as well as the new theories. All of them have to be covered by you if you're going and preparing for this exam. Leaders are born, not made. Which theory says this? Trait theory. Again, a traditional theory. So there are a lot of traditional theories. This is one of them that has been asked. So a lot of traditional theories coming up. Leadership which takes advice from subordinates and considers their feelings and emotions. This is a tricky question. A lot of students got it wrong even after reading this. Takes advice from subordinates. So the one thing that takes advice, one type of leadership, is participative. Paternalistic does not take advice. Paternalistic treats the employees as their children, as amateurs, as people who don't know anything. So it tries to give advice. He tries to lead them rather than taking advice, rather than treating them as adults. Authoritative goes out completely. No regard for feelings and emotions. Exploitative goes out. Confusion was between participative and consultative. Participative is the highest or the most advanced form, which is also at times called as democratic. And it is the one which takes advice from the subordinates and considers feelings and emotions. So if you had gone through the document which had been provided, it clearly states the difference between participative and consultative. And that is how you could have answered this question. Leadership style, in which leader's job is to set the path for subordinates. Path goal theory, again, considered and discussed in great details in the leadership theories. All these are very, static, old school and expected theories which have been asked this year. 90 marks did not go anywhere if you're good at finance and management, or even if you've covered the entire syllabus. Covered in the course completely. Theory in which subordinates measures the fairness of reward as compared to others. Equity theory, another question which was covered out there. A very basic theory. So what we are getting here is the conclusion that is coming out again and again here is that the focus was on basics this year. The focus was not on trying to gauge your level of your depth of understanding or to what extent have you gone in every chapter, but the focus was purely on coverage, okay, whether you have covered a wide horizon of theories or not. Full form of ERG under ERG theory, existence, relatedness, growth had been discussed comprehensively in the course that had been created. Again, a very simple and an expected theory. What is not a part of motivation factor in two-factor theory? Again, covered. There are hygiene factors and then there are motivators. And all both hygiene and motivators have certain sub-factors herein. Now, recognition and advancement. So, even if you did not know what are these, you could have answered this question. I don't know what the fourth option was, but assuming that there were three options, recognition and advancement. Recognition and advancement both form the higher level needs. Higher level needs when you talk about Maslow. So let's understand Maslow. So there are five needs here. Advancement and recognition come out here. And interpersonal needs are basically social needs. Recognition is a part of esteem, external esteem needs. And interpersonal is a social, which forms a part of lower level needs. And therefore, it is expected that it was a part of hygiene and not a part of motivators. So even if you had read Maslow's theory, you could have answered this question even if you have not read two-factor theory. So that was the cool thing about this question. And I think you have to apply that kind of mind when you're writing the exam and experiencing or tackling every question. So the important thing to remember here is that when you're approaching a question, approach it with the assumption that you can crack it. Don't just look at it and think, oh, I have never read this question. How am I going to be able to answer this? In fact, approach it with the belief or assumption that even if you have not read it, you can answer this question. And this was one of such questions. Let's go to the next one. One markers related to management. The first question was on decision matrix, which had not been covered. It is a part of decision theory. It is a part of decision theory which had not been covered, not mentioned in the syllabus as well, and a part of operations management, which is normally covered in management optional for UPSC or for MBAs and so on and so forth. So not covered. Of course, there will be some questions which are going to be out of the syllabus. Next question, method aimed at reducing times within production systems as well as response times for suppliers and customers. Now, this question is interesting because it is connected with another question that had EOQ and JIT as the options. Now, that question was talking about, not about response times, that question was talking about inventory cost, stock out cost, but this particular question is talking about reducing the time, response time. So it had to be the other option. So if you had answered that, and if you remembered that you answered EOQ there, then this had to be JIT, okay, because both of them are running in opposite directions. So that was important to remember. Which type of control for operational efficiency? Even if you have not read operational efficiency or control system, you could have answered this question. The answer is operational control. A very easy question again. So a lot of questions coming from control this time. Ratio of output input within time with due consideration for quality. So if you have understood the difference between efficiency, efficacy, effectiveness, you could have easily answered this question. The answer was efficiency. Productivity is a generic term which is not usually used. When it comes up to time, quality, coverage at the end of the time period, for example, results being achieved, all those form a part of effectiveness. And the basic difference between efficiency and effectiveness, which normally students get confused in, is that efficacy talks about an ideal situation. How were results achieved in an ideal situation? And efficiency talks about real time. Accurate, practical real life situations rather than ideal situations. So this is the basic difference. There was a question on 360 degree appraisal which had been covered under HRM, and normally every year a question comes on 360 degree appraisal. I don't know what the question was. Students were not able to recall the question, and therefore I've just provided the topic here. Burns and Stocker theory is related to what? If you had read Burns and Stocker theory, you would have easily answered this question, a very easy question. The answer was contingency organizations. Control that takes place before plan initiates. So another keyword here, I think even if you did not know what this is all about, you could have easily answered it, feed forward. And if you have read it, of course, there's going to be no problem. You can answer it within 10-15 seconds. Structure that cuts across department lines. We had discussed this. And as I had said in the starting of the video, the example of hospital, which fits in perfectly, had been provided by me. Which of the following is a hygiene factor in two-factor theory? See, the question is connected. There was another question, and I'm hoping that these were two different questions. I don't know, because students have provided me as these as two different questions. One was, which one is not a motivator in two-factor theory, and the other one is, which one is a hygiene factor? And therefore, the questions are connected. Okay, let's come to finance now. I hope you have understood what kind of questions and what kind of topics and what depth the questions have been asked. The question paper, mind me, was simpler this year in 2018. So in 2019, it might get a little difficult. Okay, so you have to keep that in mind. In 2017 and 16, a lot of case study based questions had been asked. So we had practiced a lot of case study based questions. Therefore, the paper looked even more easy for us. Accounting ratios, total of 8 marks, but majority of them were theory based questions. Only one question was practical. EPS, the practical question was, EPS and market price per share of 5 banks were given. So earning per share and market price. What is PE? PE is market price upon earning per share. So market price and earning per share were given, and we were asked to calculate which bank gives the highest PE ratio. Very easy question. Again, I don't have the numbers here because the students could not provide it to me, but on the face of it, looks like a very easy question, and that's what the students also said as a response. Let's come to the next question. The question says, when 1:1 bonus shares are issued, which of the following will be impacted? And the options that were given were face value reduces, no impact on net worth, so on and so forth. Now, this question is important, but because it was a very conceptual question. If you have good understanding of accounting, if you have a good understanding of, let's say, balance sheet or P&L account, only then you can expect yourself to answer this question. And on the other hand, if you understand what exactly happens when bonus shares are issued, how the accounting entries take place, how money moves in accounting terms from the reserve account to the equity share capital account, then you can easily figure it out. The answer was no impact on net worth. And we'll be talking about this, and we've already talked about this in the ratios videos. So I hope that students who had covered those videos were able to answer this question. It's about the future that we talk about this yet again. But it was a very conceptual and a very good question indeed. The next one was, what among the following is fastest driver of market price of a share? I had talked about this multiple times when we were talking about market prices of shares, PE ratio, earning per share, dividend, etc., etc. And the answer is earning per share, because earning per share is the one which drives market price of a share up or down. Return on investment comes under which ratio? A very simple question. I had already divided all these ratios into different sections, and it was an easy question. Even if you did not know them or you forgot about them, let's say, what is the meaning of return on investment? Return is money that you're getting in return for investing somewhere. So it certainly is a measure of profitability. So it's an easy question. Even if you did not know the answer, you could have answered it just by looking at the options and making a smart move out there. What are the questions related to finance current? As per budget, corporates have to raise dash capital through bonds, a current affairs based question. Which had been asked from the budget directly. Monetary policy, very basic questions had been covered by me under monetary policy section of finance theory, as well as the fiscal policy of under ESI, repo, what happens when repo is issued? It sucks liquidity, whereas reverse repo injects liquidity from the system. A very, very easy question. If you understand the basics of repo and reverse repo, you could have answered this. Rate, which is not inclusive of cost of funds, but reflects liquidity of banks. Rate which reflects liquidity of banks. Let's say you had no idea about this question. How could you have answered this? So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to assume, make those assumptions that you have not read well, or you are not able to figure out from which area is this question coming in. But looking at the question, looking at the options, you can get through a lot of questions. So the options are base rate, BPLR, MCLR, PLR, and MIBOR. Now, just listen to me carefully. All these options, A, B, C, and E, these options are connected to each other. Base rate, it started with benchmark prime lending rate, then we had PLR, then we had base rate, then we had MCLR. So all these are improvements over each other, right? But the fundamentals of all these rates have remained the same. Therefore, it could not be one of them because they are the same. In fundamentals, they are the same. Therefore, it had to be MIBOR. Okay, so that way you could have eliminated and come to the right answer. There were 10 marks worth of questions from Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, very important, and we had covered majority of them under the IBC document. Who goes for resolution to whom? This was the question, and it was directly given in the IBC document that is available online on all the websites everywhere. And when we covered IBC, we had covered this also. What is the sequence of order of payment when a company liquidates? See, this is another smart question wherein even if you did not know the answer, you could have answered it, by making certain analytics. So insolvency cost is the first cost because it is the most important one. Then you pay secured creditors just because they are secured. Then you pay workmen because they are workers of the enterprise and they have a right towards the dues that have been that they need to be paid. And government dues always come towards the end because these are the private investors per se in the enterprise, including workmen. They're also investors in the enterprise. They're investing their time and energy, and therefore government dues come towards the end. So that is how you could have answered this question, but again directly coming from IBC. Difference between DRT and LLP. DRT and NCLT. DRT is for individuals and partnerships. NCLT is for companies and LLPs. I had discussed this when in current affairs, I had created a video on IBC when IBC had started. Resolution plan for LLP and company is approved by, again, a connected question. If you knew the difference between DRT and NCLT, you could have connected and answered this as NCLT. IBC applies to which of the following? Now, the official document of IBC says it applies to individuals and companies. Individuals and companies. But LLPs are a part of companies. They are just limited liability partnerships, and so are partnership firms. They are also kind of companies, but they have unlimited liability. So the answer to this was all of the above. Six marks worth of questions from Basel, and we had covered all of them in great details. I was expecting a question from history of Basel as well, but that was not asked. But even then, the questions which were asked there were very good, and at the same time, very easy, pretty doable. Three pillars. We had discussed pillars of Basel. We had discussed all the risks of Basel, and we had discussed all the capitals under Basel and their percentages as well. Percentages were not asked, but it was asked whether it's 81, CET1. The answer was all of the above. All of them are part of capital of Basel. There was one question from Forex market. When rupee depreciates, what should RBI do? So when rupee is depreciating, you have to increase the demand of rupee. That's the concept that I'd explained to you. When the rupee depreciates, you have to increase the demand of rupee so that depreciation stops. And how do you increase the demand of rupee? By buying a lot of rupee from the market. So you sell dollars and you buy rupees. And that is how you stop rupee depreciation or a steep fall of value of rupee. And that had been covered in great details. CCIL deals with which all clearances? I don't know what are the choices because some students told me these choices, but others said the choices were different. CCIL had not been covered in great details by us because And the question was very operational, and it had been asked directly from the website of CCIL. Okay, so this was a question which was not mentioned in the syllabus as well. MPC inflation target, if it is breached for three quarters, what happens? The governor is answerable to the central government. A very important and a very easy question, because this was one of the questions that I remember I had asked in the mocks as well, and this question came directly from there. Okay. Total PSL 40% of ANBC, what is the share of agriculture? Now this is unbelievable, very important yet very easy question. In the crash course, when crash course was going on last year in the year 2018, then this amendment in PSL came through, and I remember I spent almost an entire day going through all these amendments and then creating a video on the same. PSL limit for housing loan in metros is, okay, a very simple question, very factual question. Housing loan, the answer is this. Again, very factual questions from PSL. So you need to remember, what you get is you need to remember everything when we are talking about PSL and connected things. Under PSL, what is the education loan limit to India and abroad? Now, this is something that I don't understand, because in the latest document of priority sector lending, which is available on RBI website, you have only 10 lakh, or in terms of rupees, they mentioned 1 million. Okay. But there is no mention of abroad, difference between abroad and Indian. So I don't know what the choices were, but this particular question, I don't understand this, because it's not mentioned anywhere in the official documents. Ways and means advances. Last year, this year, I've explained it in great details. It cannot be more than that. Under FRBM, the government can borrow from RBI through what? Ad hoc T-bills, ways and means advances. Even recently, we created a video on the difference between ways and means advances and ad hoc T-bills. Which of the following is not a liquidity tool used by RBI? Very easy question, mentioned in the monetary policy tools, both quantitative and qualitative. Computer terminology, OCR full form was asked, optical character recognition. Now this was covered under computer awareness, which although is not asked in RBI, but because it is asked in NABARD, therefore I had covered it and it was available there. So if you were preparing for NABARD, you could have got it right if you remembered it, but otherwise you could have got it wrong as well. A lot of students got it right, and a lot of students got stuck here. Next question is, what is the standard deduction for salaried employee under budget? So these kinds of questions from budget have never been asked. They always ask questions which have an impact on the economy, and these operational changes, operational amendments, are normally not touched. So this was something new. Okay, so if somebody is saying they had covered it, they had not. It's a lie. Okay, so because UPSC and RBI never asks these kind of questions, so they're never covered by us, because there are n numbers of, and let me like confirm it, there are hundreds of amendments which happen like this, and they can ask anything from anywhere if we start teasing that. But we have to keep it in mind from 2019, and probably we'll try and cover everything so that you don't get such questions wrong. Udyami Mitra song launched by SEBI for which sector? Launched by SEBI, I think it should not be SEBI, it should be SIDBI. I'm not very sure, but Udyami Mitra was for small and medium enterprises. PPP used in which type of sector? I had discussed this under public-private partnership and the models of PPP, and the answer is large infrastructure projects. Very easy question again. I don't know what the exact question was. This is what the feedback we've got. Budget for infrastructure sector. We don't know what the exact question and the figures and the options were. But again, another question coming from the budget. So this tells us that budget is going to be all the more important this year, just because economic survey is not going to be out. And at the same time, Niti Aayog report, whether it's finance or whether it's ESI, it's going to be very important, because these two questions can be claimed under ESI as well. They're connected with social sector of India, and therefore there's a lot of mixing happening out there. So Niti Aayog report will not only be useful in ESI but also in finance. Which one of the following is a way to raise capital online bypassing regulations? Even by looking at the answers, you could have got it right. Crowdfunding, a very popular way of raising money. A lot of crowd funders out there in news recently, and therefore this question came from the current affairs and also from your awareness level. And this was also covered in the alternative methods of financing in 2018 by me. Alternative methods of financing had been covered there. UPI is monitored. So UPI had been covered in great details, including all the provisions, all the changes made by UPI, how it works, the level of security, and it was covered that it's monitored by NPCI. A very easy and a very factual question. Maximum time for resolution under IBC. This was an easy question from IBC. Almost everybody got it right, 180 days. So a lot of questions coming from current. Okay, so finance, current, what they're doing is they're picking up the important topics under discussion and they're getting into the basics of those important topics. Fiscal deficit target for 2018-19, 3.3% discussed in the budget. So another question coming from budget here. Maximum GST rate, 28%. A question, factual question coming from GST, unlike questions which came in UPSC, which were very, very factual and almost impossible for everybody to answer correctly. There was no logic behind them as well. But this question was easier compared to that. Revised series of WPI base year 2011-12, another very simple question. In fact, I think almost all of my students know exactly what the answers to these questions were. So this was the entire paper of finance and management. I hope you have understood the topics, broadly the topics that are important. We've concluded that, finance, current, especially from RBI website, are important. Number one. Then you have Niti Aayog report this year becoming important. That is an assumption, but I'm very sure that's going to come true. Then you have the budget document gaining all the more importance this year. Then you have some questions from the conceptual basics of ratios of accounting, but I don't think that should be a cause for worry. And a lot of conceptual questions coming from management, which was simpler this year, but it might get tough. They might go back to the case study based questions which used to come, and they were all the way, way more difficult than the questions this year. So it's important that we, keep up our preparation up to that level. So all these takeaways, and of course, the finance numerical has become less important. And I'm expecting that it's not expected to gain a lot of importance. So 8 marks, out of which 2 marks were practical. This year, it might go up to 4 or 6, not more than that, because they cannot change it drastically. And the overall weightage might go up to 15, 14 or 16, something of that sort. Okay, so that might happen if they want to balance it out. But otherwise, I think finance numerical, no need to worry about it, but understand the concept. Understand the basic fundamentals behind everything you read on finance numerical. Don't just focus on the numerical portion of finance numerical. Okay, so that was all about finance and management paper of 2018. I hope you've understood and we've got some conclusions which might be helpful for the upcoming examination. And I'll soon be coming up with a detailed analysis of ESI economic and social issues as well, post which we'll be moving forward and discussing about practice questions that are expected in 2019. And I'm going to come out with some interesting things out there. All the very best. Take care.